Hello everyone, and welcome again to Nuddle, the best platform around for distance learning in business, finance, economics, and much, much more. My name is Sava, and today we are continuing our discussion of stock return modeling using insights from mathematical statistics and theoretical return distributions. Today's tutorial, or episode, I guess, is quite unusual, as we will discuss a distribution function that is probably well known to many of you, but is rarely talked about in the context of return modeling or distribution fitting altogether. You might have heard of students' t-distribution, or simply t-distribution, that is frequently used to perform the famous t-test that you all use when you want to know whether the means of two subsamples are different, whether the coefficient of a regression model is significant, and so on and so forth. But what is cool about this function is that it can be used to fit stock return data, and just as the generalized normal distribution that we discussed a couple of videos down the line, in students' distribution framework, you can calibrate the distribution so that you get any value of excess kurtosis you want. So you can get as fat tails as you'd like, as thin tails as you'd like. It's all possible with the student's t-distribution. And we've got our usual arrangement. We've got 5 years worth of S&P 500 returns. We've ranked them previously to construct the empirical cumulative distribution function and construct the theoretical normal cumulative distribution function as a benchmark that frequently underperforms, so that we can compare whether our distribution at least does a better job than normal distribution or not. So, without further ado, why is student's t-distribution so useful? Well, the only parameter that is present in the student's t-distribution is the number of degrees of freedom. And we all know that in statistical inference, in econometrics, you can always calculate what the number of degrees of freedom is by knowing the number of observations, the number of restriction that you impose on the space of variation, and so on and so forth. But degrees of freedom needn't just mean that. In case of distribution fitting, you can choose any value of degrees of freedom that you want for your theoretical distribution function. It can even be a non-whole number. It can be any real number you want. So what we are concerned with here is that there is a very nice relationship between excess kurtosis and degrees of freedom. Excess kurtosis of student's t distribution is equal to 6 over degrees of freedom minus 4. Using this relationship, we can identify what is the number of degrees of freedom that we would need to consider to get the value of excess kurtosis that we want. In our case, well, we probably remember it from past videos, but just to double check, the excess kurtosis of our empirical distribution is 3.83. So by correctly choosing the number of degrees of freedom in our theoretical student's distribution, we can match the kurtosis of the empirical distribution. So just doing some simple arithmetic here, expressing degrees of freedom in terms of kurtosis, we can see that degrees of freedom should be equal to 6 over kurtosis plus 4. So the higher is the excess kurtosis we want to achieve, the lower the number of degrees of freedom will be. And it's intuitive if you remember how t-test works. The lower is the number of the degrees of freedom, the less certain you are that the deviation that you are detecting is significant, so you need to allow fatter tails. In that case, this logic really nicely translates into distribution fitting and tail modeling. So, using this formula, we can figure out that the number of degrees of freedom that we need to input into our student's t distribution function is 6 divided by 3.83 plus 4, which is 5.57 approximately. Another issue that we need to consider is that the variance of unit student's t distribution is not equal to 1. It's actually equal to degrees of freedom divided by degrees of freedom minus 2. And it relates to the fact that if there are 2 degrees of freedom, then variance is infinite, and if degrees of freedom are less than 2, then the variance is undefined. And that's why if degrees of freedom are very small, then t-test is inapplicable. That's the logic of it. But for distribution fitting, what it means is that we need to scale our variance by the inverse ratio, like that. We need to scale it by degrees of freedom minus 2 divided by degrees of freedom, so that we can actually input our sample standard deviation or standard variance into a t-distribution function provided by Excel. But in case of standard deviation, we need to scale it by the square root of it, so by the square root of degrees of freedom minus 2 divided by degrees of freedom. So having that in mind, we can already calculate everything we want regarding the student's t distribution cumulative distribution function. So t dist of x, well, x would be just the rank return minus the mean, and we need to lock the row here, divided by, we would have just divided by the standard deviation if we were talking about the normal distribution, but here we need to scale it. So standard deviation, and we lock it, and we need to scale it by this factor. So the square root of degrees of freedom, and we lock the row in degrees of freedom as well, minus 2 divided by degrees of freedom. And we close the parenthesis again, then we input the number of degrees of freedom again, and specify that we need the cumulative function, so 1. And the bottom right clicking all the way down, we can see that the degree of fit is relatively good, especially at the very tails. But if we look at it graphically, we see that the fit is relatively good at the tails, but becomes slightly worse when we are moving closer to the hump of the distribution. So probably calibrating the axis kurtosis by just using the student's t-distribution with the arbitrary number of degrees of freedom is not the best strategy available. However, it still provides some important insights into how to model kurtosis, how to model fatness of tails, and how to use some insights from mathematical statistics in hypothesis testing, and basically export them into distribution fitting and stock return modeling. And that's all there is regarding the student's t-distribution. In later videos, we will discuss how to apply all the distribution we have learned so far to value at risk modeling and discuss what quantile functions are. As for now, leave a like under this video if you found it helpful. In the comments below, please tell me what other videos on business economics and finance you would like to see on our channel, and please don't forget to subscribe. Thank you very much, and stay tuned.